All right, so we are ready to start the next session. I am going to ask Bharti and Sharika to start their videos and unmute themselves, and we will dive right in. There you are. All right, over to Sharika and Bharti.
Hi again. Hi. Welcome, Bharti. I'm glad to see you. So I'm going to start by introducing you to the entire panel and, you know, the audience today. So Bharti Kannan is an engineer by qualification and also holds a master's degree in social sciences from PIS, which is Tata Institute, if you guys know, positioned at the confluence of her academic specializations in gender and public health. She founded Boond in 2016 as an organization that works holistically on menstrual literacy, advocacy, activism, and sustainable products. Wow, that's like amazing what you're doing. So what does social entrepreneurship mean to you, Bharti?
Thank you so much for having me here. Thanks, Sanjana. Thanks, Sharika. Social entrepreneurship is something that I didn't think that I would actually, first, entrepreneurship itself is not something that I thought I would get into to begin with. But as Boond was starting and as my life was taking a course where I wanted to figure out how I can contribute in the space of impact, that's when I realized that there's a term called social entrepreneurship. Social entrepreneurship to me means adding value that's not just business value, but adding social impact that can be captured in very measurable terms as well. These measurable terms can be quantitative or qualitative. And Boond, in my idea, has been conceptualized to be something that is a social enterprise by itself, in a gist. Right.
Wow, that means a lot though, yeah. So tell us more about Boond and what led you to start it, and where do you see it go in the future?
Sure, sorry, I'm just struggling with the video because I can't see you, I can only see my own face.
Not an issue at all.
So Boond for me started because of multiple reasons. One was because of my own journey that I took in going to this and exposing myself to some academic work and some practical work on gender and health itself. I had these diverse experiences. I remember one particular instance I like to quote is that a bunch of us as students, we were posted in Assam. And we were working in relief work for this conflict situation that was going on back then, that is still probably going on, and it's very protracted, was the conflict between Bodos and Muslims there. And at that particular point in time, about 6.5 lakh Muslims were displaced in all across different districts, and we were put up to help set up something called Minimal Initial Services Package, which basically is a gist for what is immediate relief when it comes to reproductive health. So when we were put there, we were trying to engage with the women to kind of like, one, get data, to build evidence on what's really needed. Two is to kind of like see what are the quick fixes that can be done for women there who are menstruating, who are prenatal, postnatal, so on and so forth. I realized that there is hardly any work that was being done surrounding menstruation. Yeah. And everything was subsumed under reproductive and sexual health. So that was one of my motivations. That image or that intervention has stayed with me for a very long time. But personally also, my own personal experiences surrounding menstruation with my family, stories that I've heard from my friends, how menstruation institutions interact, whether it's a workplace or a school.
Yeah.
And then over and about that, I'm introducing myself to, you know, sustainable products, which started a while ago, and how everyone was very resistant to it, and then how the trend is kind of changing. All of that culminated for me into a space where I wanted to work on menstruation itself. And that kind of led to Boond. But Boond started off with selling sustainable products because we wanted to be a sustaining organization as well.
Right. What is the future that you see for Boond? Like, obviously, after the lockdown, and I'm sure if you're not aware, recently, I think 2 days ago, I came across the shortage of sanitary pads that can happen. And in a country like India, where, you know, people are just getting accustomed to sanitary pads, if it's going to go into shortage, how are you going to bring the whole sustainable thing? So what is the future of Boond? Where do you see it going?
I'd like to look at Boond as not just a product organization. So let me say that upfront. But the bigger vision for Boond is basically to set itself up as this institution that can bring initiatives, enterprises, research and practical interventions at the confluence of science and social science itself surrounding menstruation. Right. And in that, a subset, of course, is access, availability to quality and sustainable products. To answer more specifically, it's really hard right now with respect to logistics and supply chains and accessing those who actually need menstrual products. But sustainability and sustainable products is a game changer. And when the option is provided a lot, and supposing a lot of people do choose it, then we will come to a place where even in the face of disasters or conflicts or pandemics, menstrual needs can be self-sustained if sustainable products are chosen, at least with managing the periods, not the other aspects of menstruation.
Aspects of it. Yeah, sure, definitely. Could you share with us some of the challenges in your journey with Boon, like major challenges that probably, help you like realize new things about Boon or start a new journey? So what were the challenges? Please throw some light there.
I'm going to speak. One is my own personal challenges, right? Like, I never imagined starting an enterprise. And then learning the skills to do that was the biggest challenge for me. When I started Boon in 2016, I had no clue as to, what I should do. What does it mean to actually generate value in business? What does it mean to sustain a profitable business? Or what is it? How do you look at a balance sheet, right? And all of the skills and the acumen itself was immensely lacking. I'm not saying I have it today, but I have definitely gotten better in understanding what it means to set a company, the administrative aspects behind, the financial aspects behind that. That was very limiting for me. That has been a challenge, and it continues to be a challenge in different ways because the game is also changing and I need to adapt myself and be very agile in that sense. With actually the space itself, menstruation being something that's very poorly funded to begin with, the space is very niche, let me break it down with the idea of products. There isn't like a conclusivity or an understanding of sustainable products in India or even in the world over, right? To give you an example, there is no regulation surrounding products yet, and there are some movements and some organizations coming together to establish that. So how do you actually create products and services when there is no recognition for them or a standardization or regulation around it? That's been hard as a challenge to begin with. And in every day, as being a female entrepreneur, has its own challenges. Whether you meet an investor, sometimes it's difficult. They're not safe spaces for you sometimes. I don't speak the language that business people speak in many spaces, and I want to look at impact-driven models. And that is a limiting space by itself. So these are some of my challenges per se. If I can just sum that up in that sense.
Got that. Could you highlight your favorite memories from the journey to Boon then? Some of your favorite moments that changed your journey at all?
So I think if I look back, some of my favorite moments have been like maybe... By and large, it's always like, for example, with the product itself, when you have a customer who comes and tells you, hey, this has changed my life. And this has made my menstruating experience far better. It made me more aware. It's made me access clinical help better. And those parameters. But to point out one particular instance, we were on the field in West Bengal, in some town near Durgapur. And unfortunately, that group of field interventions we did was very quick paced. So we went from one school to another because that was the particular need that the funder was insisting that we do. And I remember that these are government schools, and most of them spoke Bangla, but we had to do the session in Hindi because none of us were equipped to speak in Hindi. And I remember we mixed a little bit of English and Bangla, and I came back the next morning and I'm looking up Instagram, and this one girl has tagged us on Instagram. And I didn't expect it from a student from a government school. Of course, I'm not belittling the fact that they might not have access to a mobile smartphone, but she was so articulate and she was so clear about how she was able to look at menstruation differently and how she's been able to now have gone ahead and had conversations with her brother, with her mother, and how period blood is not dirty. So all of these small memories really add up to me and make me feel like, okay, I'm not doing something so bad also.
Yeah, exactly. I completely understand the emotion behind it. When you were sharing this story, I come to realize that, there are so many people and, how diverse India is. And all of us who are finally very, you know, as activist, if people call it, we're very activist in nature. We try to reach out to the people and try to make their lives better. But sometimes, you know, we're so off speaking in one typical language, we forget that, you know, we come from a very diverse environment and communicating there becomes a big issue. How do you manage, you know, doing such services with so many different languages in the country? I'm really appalled by this, you know, basic necessity. How are you doing it?
Like most other organizations do, they hire services where people are more skilled with, you know, different languages. But we're a very small team, and even within the team, we have a diversity in language. So at least all of us speak a minimum of 3 or 4 languages, at least. So that's helpful. And speaking Hindi and speaking a couple of Dravidian languages basically sets you comfortable to, you know, work in most parts of India, at least. But more than the language, linguistic part of it, I think the focus is always on behavior change communication. That's been a challenge to, like, see what existing behaviors are and how effectively communication can be delivered in such a way that there can be potential changes, intended and unintended changes, of course, on what we're trying to communicate within the programs. That's been a constant work, and it's like ever growing, right? Like with something as simple as hand washing that we're seeing right now with COVID. There are so many innovative ways in which people are communicating it. So that's what we want to focus on. The linguistics, there are skill sets and ways to handle that.
Right. So I'm going to head over to the chat. We're having a question from Akanksha Agarwal. She asks, how can we help Boond during the lockdown and after?
Oh, wow. So one of the first things I'd like anyone to kind of like become a patron of Boond. And a patron means multiple things. So one is, simplistically, you can evangelize sustainable products on our behalf, talk to your communities, hold sessions with your friends, circles, with your workplaces, or get us opportunities to come and meet your people. Two is that switch to sustainable products if you're menstruating. And that is need not necessarily be Boond, but anybody. Three is that we're doing a lot of writing and creative programs from Boond itself surrounding menstrual activism. So if any of you have the skill sets, just reach out to us. We're more than happy to engage people to help us get our work out there. Not just get our work out there, but also to develop work and create more portfolios surrounding menstruation. We lack human resources, so human resource will be an asset for us.
Right. I mean, I understand the importance of humans in this entire process, because the stigma that surrounds the topic of menstruation itself, it becomes very difficult to explain through, you know, we like just, you know, content and posters and all. That's when the human touch and that human interaction helps it. So I completely understand. If anyone else has questions, please do come on to the chat box and post your questions. I have another question for you because, you know, I don't know how many of them are aware of what Boond exactly does. Can you get down to differentiating about products and services that Boond provides?
Sure. So Boond works in the menstrual health space. One of the things we started out working with is selling sustainable products. So we have our own line of menstrual cups that we sell. And we also have a line of cloth pads, which we collaborate with other organizations to sell. But that's only the aspect that is tangible. So we work with on various verticals. So let me like briefly tell you what those verticals are. One is menstrual literacy. We're constantly developing content and learning about menstruation itself to be able to communicate that effectively in the different programs or the stakeholders that we engage with. So from literacy, it might be as simply as understanding what is the the history behind how a menstrual cup came, right? When was it invented? Something as simple as that, to understanding why we treat menstrual blood impurely, and and like trying to figure out scientific or like, so you know, research-based answers for that. But the next aspect is looking at programming. So we've built menstrual life skill modules, which involve a lot of things. So it's about our bodies, it's about the process of menstruation, it's about how we as menstruators can ask and demand for our rights in our families, in the workspaces that we are in. How can we responsibly manage waste? How can we reduce waste surrounding menstruation? So it covers a lot of these aspects that are very integral for us as existing menstruators. And the programming is designed in such a way that it keeps the menstruator at the center of the ecosystem. and connects with the public health delivery system, the waste management system, the teachers, the family members, so on and so forth. And then we do a little bit of advocacy, which is where, for example, we work with governments, we work with schools and the heads of institutions, or we work with corporate offices to help them design policies, to help them see what they can do for their menstruating population. So it could be something about developing a policy on period leave, but it's not just about those days of periods, because our menstrual cycle is happening all around the month,
all
right?
And, yeah.
Yeah, and there is basically the fluctuating hormones. So how do we look at that? How does a workplace create a more menstrual friendly environment, and how it has intersections in gender and health as well. So we do a little bit of that advocacy. We work with the government in helping them understand their responsibility in different ways. And then finally, we work on menstrual activism. And we do multiple things here. So we do art projects. We've tried to basically evocate conversations surrounding menstruation. So it becomes like a way for diverse stakeholders to engage with menstruation. That's hard to engage otherwise, because you have to really set space, create a safe space, engage in a prolonged period of time. But art is like one tool that we use as well. We write extensively on menstruation. And yeah, that's the gist of what Boon does.
Okay. So Pratyusha in the chat box says, please write to Pratyusha@boond.co and we can find ways to synergize. So this is for all of you who think you can, you know, participate with Boon. As you had mentioned, I think we have some more time, that, you know, you have a lot of written work. Could you tell us where we can access it, like a general public to access all this kind of knowledge?
So most of our writing happens on Medium. We have a Medium page on Boon itself, which can be accessed from the website, or just boon.co will lead you to our Instagram pages and Facebook pages. So a lot of the writing comes there as well. Some of it is very simple writing. Some of it is creative writing. A lot of it is unpublished right now. But some of the published ones that you can access, that has an intersection of science, social science, anything that you can imagine surrounding menstruation is up there for your perusal on the Medium Boon blog.
Got it. I think we have just 3 minutes left. So would you like to give us like an ending note and overall, you know, what Crimson Con is about awareness? So let's, you know, an ending message or something like that.
So I think this is a great initiative by Pink Box. In general, what I'm sensing from the Crimson Con, and correct me if I'm wrong, is that it's bringing in a lot of enterprises that work on various aspects surrounding sustainability, on menstruation, on lifestyle, so on and so forth. And I think this is the new age, not just new age enterprises and new age businesses, but new age value that will change our lifestyles for the better as well, and for the planet. So we need to proactively engage with it, and hope to have more such events offline and online as well.
Definitely. Thank you so much, Bharti. Sana, could you come back in and, you know, take over?
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for this, Bharti. I think it's been such an informative session, and we cannot wait to launch Boon on the Pink Box. Stay tuned, you guys. We'll probably do this very, very soon, hopefully in the next 5 minutes before we end this session. And thank you so much again, Bharti. This has been amazing.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Sanjana.
Thank you.